By the authority of the Veterans of Foreign Wars of the United States, the Rasmussen-Shadowski Post 4020 was organized in the city of Purim on the 14th day of January, 1945. The post was named after George Rasmussen and Joseph Shadowski, who gave their lives for their country on December 7, 1941, during the Japanese attack on Pearl Harbor. Their remains, along with the remains of 1,075 of their shipmates, remain aboard the USS Arizona, now a national memorial at Pearl Harbor, Hawaii. In every country and every time, there are ordinary people who make extraordinary sacrifices so that others may go free. They lie still, but not silent, those dead of World War II. Their deeds will speak for them forever. The battle that has ended for them has not ended for us. They want us to build, if we can, as their enduring monument, a world without war. Those who returned from the war came back to small towns, like Purim, Minnesota, and made new lives for themselves. 50 years later, a few still survive, and this is their story.
A lot of veterans have never really told their stories.
Sherman Mantz served in the European theater in World War II, moving across France where he entered combat at Metz. When the Battle of the Bulge started, he was in Luxembourg.
This repetition that they do, you're prepared, you know, you're prepared to use bayonet. And I know on guard duties at night, it'd be cold black out there, and you're standing, you get yourself back up against a tree or something and put your bayonet on your gun, and you're thinking, heaven help any son of a biscuit if he shows up. The Germans had planned this breakthrough called the Battle of the Bulge in the Ardennes in Belgium, which is a wooded area. Mm-hmm. Well, that area was supposed to be a rest area, really. They sent the 106th Division in there because they were a new division. They wanted them to get used to combat gradually. And theoretically, it wasn't supposed to be. It was a quiet sector, nothing supposed to happen in there because it's a wooded area, and they didn't think there was anything. Well, pretty soon the German all hell broke loose in there. The Germans broke. They concentrated. I don't know how many divisions in there, and the guys that were sitting right in there got just overrun, at one division. I think the division is about 12,000 men, and I think they probably lost, captured and wounded and killed about 7,000. I think it was pretty bad. Well, and you had outfits lost all, moving at night and running out of gas. I know I had three trucks, and we got lost and ran out of gas, and we had to get some gas off some tanks. Finally wound up in Reims, and then from there got back to our outfit and moved up to Bastogne. But then they eventually pushed them on.
It seemed like we kind of got the dirty end of it.
Urban Kohn served in the U.S. Army from 1941 to 1945. After training, he went to North Africa, where he fought with his unit in Tunisia, then landed on the heel of Italy. Halfway up Italy, they landed on Anzio Beach.
That was 81 mortar, that's what I was in. And they thought that was a Christmas present. Oh, God, no. That damn thing was heavy. And we carried that thing all across Africa, and halfway back and around in Italy before I finally got the heck out of there. Telling you just have to obey and yes, sir.
Paul Stebbins was with the U.S. Army 5th Armored Division, Company B, 46th Armored Infantry Battalion. He served with the 1st Army troops at Southampton as they embarked for the invasion of France.
I can recall when they invaded France, the firing of guns, bombs, what have you, it was just like daylight. Oh, well, this ain't too bad. Yeah, we didn't lose too many. I guess maybe we lost a few men, but not too many. Oh, this is war. This is fun. The river flowed red, and I'm not saying that it was made this way.
Yes,
it was blood shooting for the poor buggers. I mean, it was tough. It was rough. It was rough on us guys too. I mean, we lost a lot of men. But you get hardened into some of this. It's pretty hard work to get out of it. I mean, you don't care if you shoot somebody, or if you do shoot him, you don't care. I mean, that's your life. I'll be honest, I have shot human beings. You might as well know it, because I had to be there to do it. So I have done that. We had to call 55 howitzers on tanks. We use these 55 hours direct fire on a building. So anyway, this was the Hurtgen Forest. The boys are still in there. They went in with a company of 100 and some men. When they come out, this is what's tough to take. We came out with 50 men. We had taken a town, and this is rough. We had taken a town, and it was coming back out. Can you imagine having your own people coping upon you? Your own people shooting at you? And it happened. I was there. Seen guys get killed. Your own buddies down the road.
Well, I carried a gun, but I don't think I ever had to shoot anybody.
Alf Jorgensen enlisted in the local National Guard and served with the 135th Minnesota Regiment from 1941 to 1945. In Algiers, he took part in the summer campaign to drive the German and Italian armies out of Africa. After that, he went to Italy, where he was wounded at Anzio Beach.
You see, that was one job that you volunteered for. You couldn't order anybody to do that that didn't think they could do it. And we've got all these bodies out there in a couple of miles from here, but they brought them in and they're all laying on the ground. And they have to be identified, and the dog tags have to be taken off out of the pockets, off the neck, and put on the chest. And he says, somebody's got to help. We always ask for volunteers. He says, we're asked to try and get volunteers. So I said, well, I'll try it. I don't know how this is going to go. But I made it. I was able to do it and still sleep afterwards. And I don't know why I could do it and others couldn't. It all shot up, and you have to reach in their pockets. That's what you have to do.
John was drafted out of high school in 1943 and shipped out to England with the 612th Graves Registration Company for the invasion of France. Not long after D-Day, they were unloaded at Omaha Beach.
We had some to look out for minefields, for one thing, when we were out there. You know, I remember one place where I was a little leery about it, going out to find where they a couple of bodies were, and we were supposed to go get them. And then one cemetery, we had to get a couple of bodies down there. They'd been buried in the churchyard. And I found out that they bury one body on top of the other. It was 12 feet down to get the body, but there was arms and legs and skulls and everything in the cemetery. So they don't have the room over there that we have over here, I found out. You just wonder about, yeah, all those guys that didn't make it home.
Right.
And you just realize how fortunate you were to be able to do so.
Was there anything more that you wanted to make a matter of record for the future or anything?
Well, not any more than sing you a sentimental journey. Oh, gonna take a sentimental journey, gonna set my heart at ease, gonna take a sentimental journey to renew home memories. Got my bag, I got my reservation.
Spam, we had spam all over the country. Spam for breakfast, spam for dinner, and spam for supper.
It needed a meat cutter. So,
rats like house, size of house cats.
Old man. Yes, sir.
I was there.
Good to get home.